हरि ओम, लेट अस चैंट फ्रॉम वर्सेस 16 टू 25 ऑफ चैप्टर 7। चतुर्विध भजन्ते मा जना सुकृते नोर्जुन आतो जिज्ञासुरत्वार्थी ज्ञानी च भरत शभ ये चैतेषां ज्ञानी नित्ययुक्तः एक भक्तिर्विशिष्यते प्रियो हि ज्ञानिनोऽध्यर्थम् अहं स च मम प्रियः उदारा सत्पये वैते ज्ञानी त्वात्मैव मे मतम् आस्थित सहि युक्तात्मा मामेवानुत्तमां गतिं बहूनां जन्मनामन्ते ज्ञानवान् मां प्रबध्यते वासुदेवः सर्वमिति समाहात्मासु दुर्लभः कामैस्तैस्तैहृतज्ञानाः प्रबध्यन्तेऽन्यदेवताः तं तं नियममास्थाय प्रकृत्या नियता स्वया यो यो यां यां तनुं भक्तः श्रद्धया चितुमिच्छति तस्य तस्याचलां श्रद्धां तामेव विदधाम्यहं सतया श्रद्धया युक्तः तस्याराधनमिहते लभते च तथ कामान् मायैव विहितान् हितान् अन्तवत् तु फलं तेषां तद्भवत्पमेधसां देवान् देवयजो यान्ति हि मद्भक्ता यान्ति मामपि अव्यक्तं व्यक्तिमापन्नं मन्यन्ते मामबुद्धयः परं भावमजानन्तः ममाव्ययमनुत्तमं नाहं प्रकाशः सर्वस्य योगमाया समावृतः मूढोऽयं या विजानाति लोको मामजमव्ययम्।
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति। Start with verse number 18 onwards.
Udara sarthye vai jnani tvatmaiva me matam asthita sahi yuktatma mame vanuttamam gatim उदारा सत्पये वैते ज्ञानी त्वात्मैव मे मतम् आस्थितः स हि युक्तात्मा मामेवानुत्तमम्।
Noble indeed are all these, But the jnani, the wise, I deem as verily myself. For steadfast in mind, he is established in me alone as a supreme good. Noble indeed are all these, but the jnani, the wise, I deem as verily myself. For steadfast in mind, he is established in me as a supreme good. He is continuing with the same idea of the four classifications of devotees and how those four classifications are taken as supreme. Artha, Artharthi, Jnyasu, Jnani. The four types. If you see the four types that he is speaking about. Artha, Artharthi, Jignyasu, Jnani. And he goes on saying, all four are noble. Those who don't understand this completely, they have these gradations and dismissing the first three as useless, and they say the fourth alone is the right one. In fact, some of the readings gives this meaning only. And he goes on saying, all four are noble. So the first thing is, you can call them as four types of bhaktas or four stages in bhakti itself. You can call them as four types of bhaktas, or you can call them as the four stages of bhakti itself. Moving from materialism to spirituality. Moving from egoistic self-centered life, to remembering the divine. That's the movement in life. From egoistic self-centered life to remember the divine. So this movement he is talking about. Now in this movement, he says there are four types of seekers. Or an individual seeker also goes through these four stages. You can understand it in that way also. There are four types of people, or an individual person can go through these four stages. What are the four stages? Seekers of wealth, seekers of solace, Jignyasu and Jnani. We'll see how an individual also can go through these four stages. In the first stage, how are we justified in giving this explanation? Because he keeps on saying all four are noble. He keeps on saying that all four are noble. It means that there is something very positive about these four also. Even though in comparison, the fourth one seems to be the better, but all four are. So first thing is, the four types of bhaktas, or you can call it as four levels of bhakti itself. The moment you call it as four types of bhaktas, four levels of bhakti, automatically what comes? Comparison will start. It's natural. Automatically comparison will start. What is the comparison? Of the four, who is higher? Who is lower? Because if they say there are four people, then immediately comparison will start. What is the comparison? The comparison of, sir, naalu per irukranga, indha naalu perla yaar higher? Who is higher? And who is lower? There he is giving the hierarchy and concluding, Jnani is the the highest. Now, how can you call this as four types of bhakti itself, four types of bhaktas, or you can call them as four types of bhakti. There are four types of bhaktas and there are four types of bhakti. In the initial stage, where the person is not fully grown, asking will be very natural. Asking will be very, very natural. They keep asking. I want this, I want this, I want this. Everybody keeps asking. So what all you can ask? Dukkha Nivritti and Sukha Prapti. Dukkha Nivritti and Sukha Prapti. That's all. What else you can ask for? Distress goes, Dukkha Nivritti. Artha comes, Sukha Prapti. So the Artha Arthaarthi is attended to there. Are you able to follow? Dukkha Nivritti and Sukha Prapti. Dukkha Nivritti means I don't want pain. Even death also should be painless, sir. Yeah. I should go and sleep and then I should die. So dukkha, because even a painful death is also not. So any pain is not. Any pain causes distress and I don't want that pain. That's called dukkha nivritti. And then sukha prapti. Sukha prapti means acquiring. In order to get happiness, you need artha, wealth. So a person asks wealth for sukha prapti. A person in distress asks for dukkha nivritti. But both of them believe that God can grant them. In that sense, they are noble. In that sense, they are noble. God can grant them. You should remember the sequence. Suddenly we are saying God can grant and all. You will think all along we have been saying exactly the opposite, and suddenly from where God is coming. If you remember the sequence right from the beginning of this chapter, he spoke about the two natures of God, Paraprakriti and Aparaprakriti. He spoke about those two. Having spoken about those two, what he went on to say? Focus on the, in the initial stages, it will be apara only, and then from apara, you move on to para. Because straight away you cannot go to the higher. So, what is the sequence? First, he spoke about the Ishvara Swarupam, as it were, Paraprakriti and Aparaprakriti. And then he went on to say the cause for samsara. What is the cause for human problems? If God only is there, then where did problem come from? If Prakriti is full of me, everything is divine only, then where does problem come from? That also he answered. How did he answer that? Seeking security from the insecure objects. Seeking permanency from the impermanent nature is the cause for human problems. What is the cause for human problems? Seeking security from that which is intrinsically insecure. Seeking permanency from that which is intrinsically permanent. Seeking happiness from the world, and where world can give only. Seeking happiness from the world, and world only gives sorrow. So all these
wrong expectations, misplaced search leads to sorrow, and this is the cause for samsara. This is the problem. Now, what is the solution? Paraprakriti alone can give security and happiness. I'm summarizing right from the beginning, so that you can follow the sequence. And this is a very, very important section where devotion is rightly taught. And this is also very, very important. In fact, everything is very important in the Gita that way. Every verse we keep saying the same thing. Everything is important. So Aparaprakriti cannot give security and fulfillment. Paraprakriti alone can give. What is the solution? Surrender to God, remembering divine, surrender to God is the solution. And if you have to surrender to God, there are grades of surrender. Somehow I made a connection. I was trying to make a connection. Really, there's a connection. Huh? It's not somehow I made. I'm sure. Really, there is this connection. So, what is the solution? Solution is devotion to surrender to God as the solution. And if you surrender to God, that is called bhakti, and that bhakti is of four stages. So in the initial stage, you will chase the world for happiness, thinking that it's all done by you. Who is the artha bhakta, artha arthi bhakta now in the sequence of development? And if you observe everybody's spiritual growth also in life, how does it happen? From the materialistic life, it is theoretical to say jump to God directly. Are you able to follow? From the person who's chasing the world and involved in the world, it is theoretically correct to say go to Brahman directly. But if you start trying to practice it, you know that it doesn't work like that in reality. For you cannot jump from one extreme to the other extreme. There's a gradual progression, there's a gradual growth. And what is a gradual growth? Noble indeed are those, even if you ask God for wealth. Noble indeed are those, even if you ask God for wealth. Then where comes the problem? You start with that, but you don't end with it. Are you able to understand now? You can start with it because that's how naturally you will grow. But what you should do, you should not start with asking God for wealth, but what you don't be a devotee of God asking wealth only. Move to the next. Are you able to follow? Move to the next. What is the next? Ask for removal of pain. And then that also you start. It's okay to start there, asking God for removal of pain. But what you should not do, you ask God to remove the pain, He removes the pain. What you should not do? Don't go back and create another pain and come back. Do something where pain comes back. Do something where you don't do that. Then what happens? From artha bhakti, artha artha bhakti, you move to jignyasu bhakti. And in this Vedanta classes, we are supposed to be jignyasu bhaktas. In Vedanta classes, we are supposed to be jignyasu bhaktas and reach the state of jnani. And who is the jignyasu bhakta? Are you able to understand the sequence? First, it is okay to start with asking God, but you don't stop there. But invariably, what people do? They start and then they, once God gives them something, they stop it. They don't go to the next level. What is going to the next level? This dukkha nivritti and sukha prapti and all, from artha bhakta, artha arthi bhakta, you become jignasu. What is jignasu? You start asking, what is the true nature of God? The inquiry starts. That's where a bhakta also becomes an inquirer. In Vedanta classes, what are we attempting? We are attempting this merger. We inquire about God. We talk about God. We give various definitions of God, various sakuna, upasana of God, and all that we give, backed by what? Tatvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. As he said in verse number 34, chapter 4. So a jignyasu is one who has this devoted inquiry, not a doubtful inquiry. You can inquire in two angles. One is you can doubt. One is you can doubt and ask a question. Another is what? With devotion, to get a clarity, you can ask. So with devotion, to get clarity, if you ask questions, digesting this Vedantic knowledge and getting to know the true nature of God and etc., you become a jignyasu bhakti. Here, what happens? Knowledge is not opposite of bhakti. Knowledge is not opposite of bhakti. Otherwise, there is a very big problem. There's a very big problem. What is the problem? People keep saying, before coming to the classes and all, I had lot of bhakti, sir. After coming to the classes, even the little bit of bhakti I had and all is gone. What to do now? What is the answer? You never had bhakti in the first place. You are imagined. If you can imagine whatever you want. If you had real bhakti, it wouldn't go. In fact, knowledge will only make it. Knowledge will stabilize the bhakti. Knowledge will not take the bhakti away. But people come and say, having coming to these classes, even the little bit of devotion I have is gone. So neither are they establishing the fourth stage of jnani, nor are they the jignyasu bhakta. Then where do they fall into? They fall into mere intelligent Vedanti. Intelligent Vedantin means who can criticize about, who can talk about others, who can criticize about others, who can be a very good professor, but doesn't really grow spiritually. Are you able to follow? So here he says, from jignyasu bhakta, you become a jnani. And who is a jnani? Now we have to give this interpretation, because every verse is saying all four are noble. All of them are in the 10th class. In the 10th class, this fellow comes first. Right? All are in 12th class, but in the 12th class, this fellow comes first. Who is that fellow? That's what this verse number 18 says. Noble indeed are all these, but the jnani I consider to be wise. So you find all the divine shlokas and things, praying to God and all, is essential steps that you have to cross. But where it becomes a mistake is if you get stuck there. Invariably, what happens? People don't move and they are stuck. So you can call them as four types of bhaktas, or four stages in bhakti itself. For reflection purposes, use both. First, you understand all four are separate. and each one is stuck in one, and then the fourth one is better, and then to the next level of reflection you take all the four in one human being, and the human being going through this stages, maybe in one janma or many janmas. That's what is going to say next verse. See, these four stages, Arjuna, may happen in one janma or may happen over many janmas, but there are these four stages. Of the four stages, why I consider jnani to be the best? Because even the jignyasu bhakta also is still talking about me, wanting to know about me, trying to inquire about me, trying to understand me. And why the jnani bhakta is the supreme most? Because he has become me. Everyone follow? Jnani bhakta is superior. Why? Because he is no more talking about me. He is no more building temples for me. He is no more worshipping me. He has become me. These four stages of bhakti is what happens in four stages of growth. Bhakti, jnanam cuts ignorance. Correct? Jnanam cuts ignorance. Bhakti makes the process of removing the ignorance joyful. Remember that. Always you should remember. And the famous oft-repeated example of Swamiji is what? The piston. Remember that example? The cylinder and the piston. All of us know the example. I'm only talking about the concept behind the example. The knowledge removes ignorance. Bhakti makes the process of removal of ignorance joyful, blissful, happy. Pure jnanam alone makes it look like a dry thing, isn't it? It looks like a very dry thing. Talking, cutting, ignorant, removal. It looks very, that aspect of, where is the joy in the removal of ignorance? Bhakti is that which brings in that happiness, that joy. And this joy, happiness happens in four stages again. Salokyam, Samipyam, Sarupyam, Sayujyam. And this happiness that human being derives happens in four stages again. What are the four stages? Ellam 4-4 vaing. Somewhere it will be 3-3. Here it is 4-4-4. Again it goes into the four stages. What are the four stages? Salokyam, Sarupyam, Samipyam, Sayujyam. The Jignyasu Bhakta is Samipyam, is very close. Because of using the right instrument, intellect, not just getting emotional about the whole thing, he is using also his intellect and properly gaining knowledge and understanding. Jignyasu Bhakta is Samipya. He is very close. And the closeness itself can become so. And the closeness itself can become so joyful, a lot will get stuck there also. And who is a jnani? Who is a jnani bhakta? Who's our name you can give, isn't it? Jnani bhakta you can give. Yeah. Because in the context of 7th chapter, you have to call him as jnani bhakta only, because that's what he's saying. And who is he? Who's attained that? Sayujyam. Sayujyam means the merger, the union. Salokyam. What is Salokyam? Occupying in the same vicinity, in the same area. Yeah. Salokyam it is. What is Salokyam? My daughter should get married and be in Chennai only, sir. Going to America and all, that is Salokyam. You're able to call it? This is called Salokyam. Hong Kong, what will you do? Yeah, Hong Kong, Ukanda, Mars, Ukanda, what do we do? Isn't it? You go to Hong Kong, go to Mars, you go to Pluto, where all people go, isn't it? America. So Salokyam means in the same loka, meaning in the same vicinity, at least the same, that is called Salokyam. Happiness of inhabiting the same place. That is Salokyam. Then comes Samik. Then comes Samipyam. Gaining vicinity, getting closer. Then comes Sarupam. Sarupam means FaceTime le paakla. We are not talking on FaceTime only. We are not doing Zoom classes only. Yeah. Sarupyam means direct seeing. When is it, when that direct seeing is going to happen, God only knows, sir. And I'm also getting so used to it. I don't have to drive the car, no, nothing. Yeah. I can just till 7:40 I can read newspaper, just put the kurta, come and sit and start. Yeah. Start talking this Zoom and all. So Sarupyam. Sarupyam means you actually see it. Sayujyam means the Sayujyam is the merger. So the four stages of happiness. What are the four stages of happiness? Salokyam, Samipyam, Sarupyam, Sayujyam. Don't make the mistake of Artha Bhakti to Salokyam. Don't do that connection. Otherwise, you'll go. That connections and all, you don't. Bhakti gives you happiness. What is happiness? The happiness of removal of the process of removing ignorance is made joyful, blissful by the practice of bhakti. We are not changing. Krishna is not changing the sequence. It is jnanam alone. That's very clear. It is knowledge alone that's going to do that. It's very clear. But the process of gaining knowledge, how to make it? The process of knowledge must be a very pleasant, blissful, joyful experience. It must be a pleasant, joyful, blissful experience it should be. How to do that? Remember the divine. And when you are remembering the divine, you will go through these four. When you remember the divine, you will go through these four stages. And what are the four stages? The four stages of bhakti. At the first level, we will make an effort to become a Jignasu Bhakta. Jignasu Bhakta here, context is, as you are remembering God, you inquire about what is the true nature of God also. God as just the boon giver. God as just the one who is satisfying your desires, wishes. From that very, very tribal notion of God, your understanding of God becomes more subtler, more refined. How did it become subtler and refined? By asking, by inquiry, by studying, by questioning, by reflecting. The bhakti becomes more and more refined. When bhakti becomes more and more refined, the external paraphernalia of bhakti reduces. When bhakti becomes refined, the external paraphernalia reduces. Because there is no external paraphernalia, there is no external manifestation, jnani seems to be having no bhakti at all. Because he doesn't do that external paraphernalia, naturally reduces, but external paraphernalia reduces, but the awareness of the divine becomes, the awareness of the divine becomes sharper, precise. Why? He's not simply doing a ritual, he's not simply doing a prayer in the name of bhakti, he's not simply doing a prayer in the name of bhakti, he's not simply doing a ritual, he is also doing shravana manana. As he is doing that, he is doing this also. We should bring the connection and brainwashing and hypnotism should not stop. We have to bring in the connection. And there is such a beautiful connection. Yah pashyati, whoever sees it, there's a beautiful. So what does the Jignyasu Bhakta does? Not only he is simply doing the devotional practices, he is also started to ask questions about the true nature of God. When he is asking about questions about the true nature of God, where does answer come from? From the beginning of this chapter, Paraprakriti and Aparaprakriti. There are two natures. One is that Aparaprakriti, and then there is a Paraprakriti, and then all that you see is all that, etc. I'm not going into those details now. You should remember all that. At least till we finish the chapter, you should remember. When you go to the next chapter, you can forget. And this happiness that human being derives, the spiritual happiness, the bhakti, how does it grow in bhakti? Salokyam, samipyam, sarupyam and sayujyam. That is where you find the bhakti schools defining moksha also into these four categories. The bhakti schools define moksha into these four. They say, some occupy Vaikuntha in the same loka. Some occupy Vaikuntha in the same loka they are. Same loka means in the same. Long ore area la irukrom sir avladha, isn't it? We are all in the same area, isn't it? The fact that we both are in the same vicinity itself is so joyful, correct? So joyful, isn't it? Same vicinity. The example that Swamiji gives us, what is the example that he gives for these four stages of happiness? We all know that example. That's why I'm not elaborating that example. What is the example that he gives? The father experiencing the happiness when the son comes abroad after a long period of study and etc. The son is coming. How does it work? The father is in Pune. The son landed in Mumbai. And from Mumbai, he's calling and say, I have landed. The fact that the son says, I have landed, there is a joy. Correct? Are you able to understand that joy? That is called Salokyam. Why that joy? Because the merger is going to happen. What gives the joy there? Very soon, that fellow will come closer to me. Very soon, I can see. Very soon, I can become one. Are you able to follow? That is the happiness. That is happiness. And then, he has taken the car and closeness to the object. Closeness. What is the closeness? He's saying, I'm just in the road nearby. You take one right, you are in. And the father is going to the terrace, looking at the looking for the car. Samipyam, the closeness has come. The third is what? Sarupyam. What is the sarupyam? He sees the sun getting down from the car, and when he sees the sun getting down from the car, there is the joy. The last is jnani. Yeah, that is the jnani happiness. What is the jnani happiness? Sayujyam. Sayujyam means the union happens. The union happens. That's where you find some of the pictures of Hanuman and Rama hugging each other, no? Have you seen some pictures where Hanuman and Rama are so close to one another? This is called Sahijyam. All happens is based on the closeness to the object of desire. There are grades of closeness. Same area, getting closer, you can actually see previously it used to happen, no? You are waiting in the railway station to pick that person. All that you see is the engine only. Yeah. All that you see is the engine only, and the very fact you see the engine itself is so joyful. And see the person getting down, you see the compartment number, more happy. And you see the person waving through the window, rupiam. And then the person get down, even if the person is dirty, carrying all COVID and all, you will still go on. Yeah, you still go on. Hug, that is sayujyam. Jnani is best, Arjuna, because he knows the sayujyam happiness. The first three category knows only the closeness of happiness, and the jnani knows the happiness of sayujyam. Therefore, I consider him as myself. Look at that. I consider jnani as myself. I consider you as myself means we both have become one. So bhakti essentially culminates in the oneness. Knowledge culminates in oneness. Bhakti also culminates in oneness. If you understand it like that, you will know how to know that jnanam and bhakti are not separate to each other. They are not in conflict with each other. Otherwise, there is always a difficulty. What is the practical difficulty? Jnanam is opposite of bhakti. Or they say, when jnanam comes, bhakti goes out. Where bhakti is there, there is no jnanam. Here he says it doesn't work like that. So to summarize this verse, you can understand it like four types of bhaktas, or four stages in bhakti. Four types of bhaktas or four stages in bhakti. And of the four stages, wherever they talk about four, what will happen? Comparison will start. And comparison means, what is best? What is low? What is high? What is best? What is worst? All are in 10th class, but this fellow comes first. Are you able to follow? It's not that only one fellow in 10th class, rest are all illiterates. It's not that. All are in the same class. But this fellow is the best. And the four stages of happiness is brought about to explain what? how the happiness grows. The four stages of happiness is spoken about to say how the happiness grows as you evolve spiritually. This is verse number 18. Yes, there's a clarification.
In Savlokyam, Samikyam and Sarvyam, what I'm not able to understand is, example is understood, but I'm not trying to understand what I'm supposed to get from that. What am I supposed to learn? What is it going to be like between Bhakta and a God?
Yeah.
How should I rightly understand? Example with reference to father and son or there, any there. Worldly relationship is okay.
The question that she is asking is, how to understand these four stages with reference to the example, it is clear. But what is it what is the takeaway from this?
Yes, I don't understand. That's in all three stages, what is the first, second, third stage? Individually, how should I understand?
Beings derive happiness in four distinct stages. Do you understand that?
Huh.
There are four grades of happiness. Mm-hmm. Do you understand that? Yes or no?
Yeah.
Yes. Four stages means in the increasing order of subtlety. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? In the increasing order of subtlety.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine the same example. Because without example, you cannot understand the concept.
Okay.
What is the example? Imagine your daughter. The fact that she is landing. You have been longing. Happiness comes from what? What is the cause for happiness? This is common sense. You should be, you should know it already. You are able to follow? Happiness comes from where? Longing, correct? Longing. The intensity of the longing. Longing and the intensity of the longing. So you are longing for the daughter and the fact that she has landed. There's a happiness. Correct? And then she is getting closer. More happiness. You see at the airport, landed, immigration check, more happiness. You can see through the glass that collecting the baggage, more happiness. Where does it culminate? Where does it end? Where does it end? I'm asking, where does it end? It ends only when the union happens. Everyone follow? It ends only when the union happens. Union means?
Here it is realization.
Union means the two should become one.
Hmm.
The two should become one. What is two becoming one?
Aham Brahmasmi.
Hmm.
That's all. The last stage, but first is three.
Yeah, the first three is as you grow, there are the stages of happiness. Do you understand there are stages of happiness as you grow? As you grow, as you do the study, reflection properly, and do all the spiritual practices properly, you know that there is a growth happening in you, and the fact that you can recognize the growth happening in you gives you a happiness, and that happiness is divided into these four categories. That's all. It's a broad categorization. You should think about it and then ask. These are the four broad categorization happens as you evolve spiritually. These are the four stages of happiness. As you move from one stage to the next, you derive greater happiness. In the spiritual path, what is the happiness in the spiritual path? in the context of bhakti. What is happiness? I said that already. Seeing God as a mere boon giver, seeing God as the one who are just going to satisfy your desires and wishes, the understanding of God becomes subtler and subtler. The understanding of God becoming subtler and subtler is greater joy, and that joy is of these four, is broadly categorized into these four types. You follow? Your understanding of God becomes subtler and subtler. Subtler and subtler means getting closer and subtler and subtler means getting closer and closer. You follow? This is verse number 18, where he talks about these four stages. What are the four stages? Salokyam, Samipyam, Sarupyam, and Sayujyam. Is growth gradual or is growth sudden? Is growth gradual or sudden?
Gradual.
What is spiritual growth? The negative way of saying spiritual growth, the positive way of saying spiritual growth. What is the negative way of saying spiritual growth? Desires are removed, ignorance is removed. That is the negative way. What is the positive way of saying spiritual growth? What is the positive way of saying the same thing? Your joy, your bliss increases. Your bliss goes on increasing. And what causes this bliss? You know that you are getting closer and closer. When you realize that you are getting closer and closer, is there not a happiness? Purely a subjective experience it is. Jnanam can be spoken about as a concept. Bhakti is a pure subjective experience. That subjective experience he is trying to explain in what terms? As you are getting closer and closer, happiness increases. You know that you are getting closer and closer. That's where the happiness comes from. Are you able to understand the example? You know that you are getting closer and closer. How do you know that you are getting closer and closer? If you do the study rituals, Shravana Manana properly, do Karma Yoga properly, get rid of the anxiety for the result, whatever the spiritual practices are told, and if you are practicing it dedicatedly, there is a gradual growth, and that gradual growth tells you that you are getting closer and closer. Why he considers the jnani as the best? Because most of the people get stuck at somewhere. They stop the pursuit somewhere, they get stuck, and some happiness they derive, and that happiness itself is so satisfying, they stop. Krishna is saying, till you get to the ultimate, you should not stop. What is the ultimate? The Sayujyam. The two becoming one. And the two becoming one, sudden or gradual? Any growth is gradual. It means happiness also progresses. If everything is gradual, happiness also progresses gradually. And those gradual progression of happiness is divided into these four categories: Salokyam, Samipyam, Sarupyam, and Sayujyam. Sa plus Loka, Sa plus Samipya, that's how the Sanskrit grammar goes for all this. But all means the distance between the desire and the object of desire and the desirer. There is a distance between object of desire and the desirer. joy happens when both are getting closer and closer, culminating in sayujyam. That's why sayujyam is the hug. Hug means the two becoming, not the physical hug. Doesn't mean we have to go on hugging everybody, isn't it? Irritating, you know. We need not do that. That conceptually. And when you hug, how do you hug? How hug happens? The bones get crushed, no? Isn't it? How do you hug? You hug with such. With so much of love. And what is that love? Love cannot tolerate duality. Yeah? Love means love cannot exist in duality. So all the effort of love is the two to become one. And when the two is becoming one, it happens gradually. Where does it start? First, remember the divine. Even for wrong purposes, if you are remembering the divine, doesn't matter. Simply remember. Why? Because this remembrance of the divine alone will bring about the inquiry. First, you have to remember, associate, and then inquire. And when you inquire, what do you inquire in this context? The Paraprakriti and Aparaprakriti. That's what the inquiry is. Meaning the true nature of God. The true nature of God moving from the boon giver to the Sakshi, the enlivener, finally culminating in saying, I am God. And whoever says I am God, he is a jnani, and that person I deem as myself. Why? For they are steadfast in me, established in me. That we saw already in the last verse also. Steadfast in me and established in me. Steadfast means steadfastness. What is steadfastness? Ananya chinta. That's what is called steadfastness. Established in me means wanting the ultimate union to be the at what stage the lover stops till union happens, no? At what stage the lover will stop? Salokim. There is a happiness, but then some attempt will be made to get to the state of samipyam. There is a happiness in samipyam, but then will it stop there? If you want to understand this, use another example, very practical example, but it's maybe a little bit gross, but it will convey the point very well. When the boy or girl starts courting each other, how does it happen? Teenage stuff. Yeah. So we all born a janmali, we had teenage, sir. No, where did you? Yeah. You were in teenage last janma. How do you remember all that? Are you able to follow? How does it start? Salokyam, in the same area. Yeah. The girl may not even come out of the house, but the boy will be going up and down the street, isn't it? What is the happiness that he is getting by going down the street up and down? What is the happiness? Okay. But then will he stop there? If he stops there, he will miss, correct? So what he will do? He will do something to gain vicinity. He will do something to get closer. And getting closer gives, and getting closer gives another happiness. And then comes some whistling he will do, isn't it? Some whistling he will do, some singing he will do, something he will do. And the girl comes out of the house. We come to Vellagoda Varvana. Window Mulema Pathalepo, isn't it? Through the Sarupyam. Abba, Inniki Pathitampa, isn't it? They talk amongst themselves, no, what they. I just saw the girl today. But does it stop there? Where does it stop? Where it will stop? It will stop only when the two merges into one. Bhakti starts with two and ends with one. It is not jnanam only that ends with one. Even bhakti, even love also, that starts with one, starts with two and ends as one. And who is a jnani? A jnani is one who has achieved this. A jnani is one who has achieved this status. Therefore, I consider him to be the best. I consider him to be the best. We'll move on to verse number 19. Verse number 19, Varinga.
Bahunam janmanamante jnanavan mam prabhadyate vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sudurlabha. Bahunam janmanamante jnanavan mam prabhadyate vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sudurlabha.
At the end of many births, the man of wisdom reaches me, realizing that all is Vasudeva, reality. Such a great soul is very difficult to find. Samahatma sudurlabha. Durlabham means difficult. Sudurlabha means extremely difficult. Extremely difficult means rare. Very, very rare. You don't get them in hundreds and thousands. You get them, you can count them with your samahatma. Such a person is very rare, very difficult and rare to find. Who is he called? He is called the Mahatma. Such a great soul. What is it? Again, very poetic verse. Has to be understood rightly. Bahunam janmanamante jnanavan mam prapadyate. These four stages that I told, in the previous category, the artha, arthaarthi, jignyasu, jnani and all, to get to the state of jnani, bahunam janmanam. At the end of many births, the wise man comes to me. At the end of many births, the wise man comes to me. What is he talking about? He's talking about the gradual progression. He's talking about the gradual progression. It takes a lot of effort to come. It takes many births, many janmas. Many birth, many janmas. Meaning, the spiritual pursuit starts and it carries over. It carries over many janmas. Carries over many janmas. One way of looking at it is getting disillusioned. Oh my God! Abdina in the janmatla varada sir. Abdina waste utrala. Meaning, since it will not, since it is not going to happen now, immediately you drop it. So most of the people, what they do, either they have to get it immediately. If they don't get it immediately, they drop. And if you see, most human beings belong to this category only. Either they should get it immediately or they just drop. So that is a negative way of interpreting the same verse. What is a positive way of interpreting the same verse? Little bit of effort you do, even the little bit of effort you do will not go waste, and it stays with you. Even the little bit of effort you do doesn't go waste. Vasudevah sarvamiti. Jnani understands. Vasudevah sarvamiti. Vasudevah sarvamiti is the language of bhakti. Isavasyam idam sarvam is the language of jnanam. But both are saying the same thing. Isavasya says it as Isavasyam idam sarvam. That's the language of jnanam. The language of bhakti is Vasudeva sarvamiti. A person who has understood this is Sudhurlabha. Extremely rare. And what is the positive way of looking at it? The positive way of looking at it is a fact that I am able to associate with this knowledge, with the very this way and all that. Definitely, this is not the starting point. Maybe this is the last janma. This is how the jnani sees it. The very fact that I am able to associate. Are you able to follow? The very fact that I am able to associate with something very meaningful. The very fact that I am able to associate with something that is so extraordinarily wonderful, you understand. It all happens because of what they call as sukrutam, isn't it? Purva janma sukrutam. The good deeds of the past is that which helps you to associate with the highest now. Therefore, the same verse gives you the conviction that it can be the worst, or the same verse, it can give you the conviction that it is the ideal thing to happen. Are you able to follow? Second thing, are you okay till now? Second important thing is, a jnani is not a result-oriented person. Asking when it will, a jnani is not a result-oriented person of asking in the janmale mudjiruma sir. I want to achieve it in this janma itself. It's a clear indication of result. It's not mumukshatva alna. Commissioner. No, it's not mumukshatva. It is a clear indication of result orientation. Because it should happen. Jnani says, it is going to happen whether in this janma or many janmas. Doesn't make a difference for that. Salokyam, samipyam, sayujyam, all that is happening. No, so he knows that he is in the, he knows that that person is on the path, and there is a gradual growth and recognition will happen. Bahunam jinmanam ante jnanavan mam prabhattite. So he doesn't get disillusioned. The third factor of this is bahunam jinmanam means effort is required. Because in the context of grace, you can't miss the effort. Bhakti, 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 grace, 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 we are talking. In the context of grace and bhakti and all that, you should not get too carried away by this and miss the... You should not get too carried away by the anugraha part and miss the effort part. Therefore, wherever he gets a chance, he reminds you of that also. What is the reminder? Effort is also... required. Effort also goes along with it. And this effort is bahunam. Bahunam janmanam. This bahunam janmanam, you can take it as this janma as the starting point. or you can take it as this janma as the end. Having gotten into this Bhagavad Gita study and the fact that we are surviving week after week after week. And when I see the same people coming week after week after week, I get very confused. How are they surviving? Clear? I myself is not very clear about what I am talking. And how people come and sit and listen to the same thing again and again and again. It means that Bahunam Janmanam and all has started. It means Bahunam Janmanam and all has started long back. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Samahatma Sudurlabha. This is not the first birth. Therefore, we may be very near the goal. We may be very near. Janma means birth. Janma means the field of activity. Janma means birth. Also, janma means the field of activity. Bahunam janmanam ante means you have to go through many types of activities to get there. That's where the lot of karma yoga, bhakti yoga, study, reflection. Are you able to follow? All these very many activities combined over a period of time is called Bahunam Janmanam. It's not, you should know, the Sanskrit words have so much of meanings to the subtlety. So it doesn't mean it's only the particular physical birth. It means the various fields of activity that one has to be engaged in to become the Mahatma Sudurlabha. And that Mahatma Sudurlabha, what does that person understand? Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Vasudeva Sarvamiti means, in the language of Upanishad, how would you call it as? I said it already. In the Upanishadic language, what we call it as? All are, everything is divine. In fact, there is only one. What? Divine. Isavasyam idam sarvam. The language of the intellectual versus the language of the devotee. But both are saying the same thing. What is the language of the devotee? Vasudeva sarvamiti. And then people take it as, wow, he has said it, no, very clearly, Krishna only. It means non-Krishnas are all something else. Huh? Supposing if you don't know Krishna at all, then what do you do? No, you have to know Krishna only to become. What do you do then? So, Vasudeva Sarvamiti is the language of Bhakta. But both means the same. What is it? All are divine. In the first few verses of this chapter, Krishna said everything is divine. Here, who is saying everything is divine? Who is saying everything is divine here? The person who has gone through this Bahunam Janmanam Ante Sudurlabha, that Mahatma is saying. It means what? What is said in the beginning is being experienced now. What was told by God has become a matter of experience for this person here. Samahatma Sudurlabha. This is not the verse for pessimism. It's not the verse for pessimism. This is the verse that you look at it rightly. Also, this verse talks about the rarity. How rare it is. How this Mahatma is rare. How rare it is to be born as a human being is Subhrutam. Yeah. To be born as a human being is rare. Being born as a human being, not to indulge and get lost in the materiality is still rare. And those who remember God and divine is more rare. Of those who remember the God and divine, those who try to understand God in the true sense is rarer. Finally, if you go on filtering, this rare one, Mahatma Sudurlabha, you will find a lot of Artha Bhaktas, you will find a lot of Artharthi Bhaktas, you will find a few of Jignyasu Bhaktas, but this Jnani Bhakta is very rare, Arjuna. Jnani Bhakta is very, very rare. Before he is Sudurlabha, it is very difficult. Why this person is rare? Because the other three are able to associate with the divine but making use of it for the wrong purposes. Actually, we should not call it as wrong purposes. You should call it as limited purposes. The first three categories also remember God. Not only they remember God, they make use of God for limited purposes. What is the limited purposes? Sukha prapti, dukkha nivritti, satisfying the intellectual curiosity. All are limited purposes. A jnani is one who rose above this limited usages and reached the ultimate. He rose above the limited. What is the limited uses? Dukkha Nivirti is one, Sukha Prapti is another. Okay, all these two you achieve, then the third problem starts. What is the third problem? Intellectual curiosity. And you can become a Jignyasu Bhakta, start reading the scriptures, coming to the classes, attend everything, and get a theoretical understanding and be satisfied with that also. This Mahatma is rare because there is a happiness in that, but he made the effort not to get stuck there. There is happiness at the second level. He made an effort not to get stuck there. There is an extreme, there is a very subtle happiness at the third level and made effort not to get stuck there. So at every level, he experiences a happiness, a bliss, also ensuring that he doesn't get stuck. Experiencing happiness, make sure that he doesn't stuck. Experiencing happiness, he doesn't get stuck. Ensuring the subtlety of happiness, he doesn't get stuck. Till what? He becomes a jnani. And if you look at jnani, you can recognize the tremendous effort that it has happened. The tremendous, what is the effort? Because the subtlety, the joys are so subtle. The happiness is so subtle. The joys are so subtle. Tendency is to get stuck. Because of his ananya chinta, he moved on. And the effort is for ananya chinta. This is verse number 19. Bahunam jinmanam ante jnanavan mam prapatyate vasudeva sarvamiti samahatma sudurlabha. At the end of many births, the man of wisdom reaches me, realizing all is Vasudeva. Vasudeva here refers to Vasudeva, meaning son of Vasudeva. Who is Vasudeva? Krishna. So he's saying, at the end of many births, the wise man reaches me, realizing all are Krishna. Krishna represent reality. Krishna is the symbolic representation of the reality. not the body of Mr. Krishna. Not the body of Mr. Krishna, but what Krishna symbolizes, what Krishna represents, what Krishna represents. For that matter, all enlightened masters represent the supreme reality. And such a person is rare. Samahatma Sudurlabha. Such a person is rare indeed to find. Rare indeed to find is a motivation to make it beautiful, isn't it? Rare indeed means there is a motivation, no? Isn't it? Value goes higher and higher only when it gets rare. Rarity indicates the value, isn't it? Sometimes they bring about limited editions, no? And the limited editions are expensive than the normal edition. Why the limited? Because only very few can. Everybody is having the same thing versus you alone having it. Samahatma Sudurlabha means it is rare. And who is that rare? Every one of us is rare. That's how you should conclude. Who is rare? No, don't look at. Who is rare? No, don't look outside. Don't start comparing. Who is rare? Individually, you are rare. Individually, you are rare. It starts with you and it ends with you. Samahatma Sudurlabha. The small percentage turned towards God spiritual. Of that small percentage that turn towards spiritual, there are these four types. Artha, Arthaarthi, Jignyasu, Jnani. Of that limited edition, one alone is supreme. And what makes that one supreme? Because he recognizes. What is the recognition? Vasudevaha sarvam iti. All is Vasudeva. Reality. This is verse number 19. With this, we conclude verse number 19. Questions?
Yes, Chandralekha. Yeah, Chandralekha. Venkatachalam. Mala.
Yeah. Chandralekha. Oh, the piston example. Oh, yeah, okay. Oh, sorry. See, the piston example is, there is a cylinder and then there is the piston. The example that Swamiji gives is the cylinder and the piston. Now, the cylinder is rusted and the piston will not go in. The piston will not go in smoothly. Therefore, for the movement to happen effortlessly, what should happen? The piston should just slide in. It means a preparation is required. What is the preparation? You remove the rust inside. You remove the rust and you polish the piston. And then you lubricate it with oil. The inner side of the cylinder and the outside of the piston is both lubricated with oil. Once all this preparation is done and you keep the piston on top, what happens? It just slides into it. So the preparation is, jnanam is like, jnanam is removal of rust and everything. Oil is the bhakti. So the oil of devotion makes the movement, makes the transformation easy. This is the example. Is it okay, Ma?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. This is example that he gives. Always to talk about the how jnanam and bhakti are together, as misunderstood as they are two separate. As not only they understand it as separate, most misunderstand them to be opposite in nature. Here he is saying they are not separate, they are not opposite, but they complement one another for the union to happen. That's the concept. Is it okay, ma?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Next one is Venkatachalam, ma? Yeah. Is a progression through the four stages of bhakti driven by choice? Yes. It is by choice. Free will, choice. It is by choice only. Because effort. Free will means choice means effort. So the mind is enjoying that happiness, but the effort says, go to the next. For the destination is not this. So remembering what the destination is drives the effort. It is the effort, but the effort is made possible because you remember the, you are able to remember the destination. What is the destination? The merger is the destination. Therefore, it is driven by free will, and the free will is remembered by remembrance of the ultimate. If the remembrance of the ultimate is not there, you can misunderstand at any level as ultimate and get stuck there, thinking that you have reached the ultimate. That's why the goal is always elaborated and explained first. Is it okay, Venkatachalam?
Yes. My point was, I think I'm satisfied with the answer. Though what I was trying to understand is it it is not based on mere desire.
Yes.
It is mere desire. You may stop at one stage.
Yes.
So it is only a free will that you keep going.
Yes. It's not just the desire. For desire is born of knowledge and understanding here. A desire that is born of knowledge and understanding. The desire that is born of knowledge and understanding is called mumukshatva. So the effort driven by mumukshatva. That has to be connected. Effort that is driven by mumukshatva. And mumukshatva is that mumukshatva is that which comes out of? Mumukshatva is a desire, but the desire born out of a desire born of knowledge and understanding.
Knowledge and understanding.
Is it okay, Venkatachalam?
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Yeah. Next one. Next year is
Mala.
Yeah. Yesterday you said the intrinsic values come along with us to our next birth. Yesterday I said that.
I didn't get that. Could you try again?
I also didn't get it. Mala, I'm not remembering what I said today.
Sir, you said the intrinsic value is the one that comes along with us when we move from one birth to another birth, as quoted by Dharmaraja.
Yes.
So my question is, gunas, the sattvic, tamasic gunas, do they come along, which is, I suppose, part of the mind?
Yes.
And does the intellect also come along, or what?
In the ultimate sense, what is your intrinsic value? What is your intrinsic value, that which you can never lose? Brahman, the consciousness. That is your intrinsic value. In a very relative sense, we say mind and intellect and all is coming. But when Yama is talking, he's not talking about how you are moving from one body to another body. It's not the topic of discussion there. The topic of discussion is when all that gets dissolved, when everything gets dissolved, what remains? Mind is also gone. Intellect is also gone. Everything is gone. When everything is gone, what remains? That is the intrinsic value. When everything else is gone, what will remain? Brahman. And that Brahman cannot be taken away by anything. In fact, you have no choice from Brahman. You have choice only with relation to ignorance. When it comes to Brahman, you have no choice. Why? Because you are that. You are that already. Therefore, when we say the intrinsic value that comes, we are not talking about Brahman with body, with mind and intellect, vasanas, gunas and all that. We don't. Yama is not talking about the transmigration from one body to another body. Vasamsi jirnani yata vihaya navani grinnati naroparani. There we are talking about how the jiva moves from one body to another body. Here we are not talking about jiva moving from one body to another body. There he is talking about the mind is gone, the intellect is gone, everything is acquired. No, gunas are also acquired. Gunas are also acquired. Everything is acquired. So all that is acquired will be lost. When all that is acquired, when all that is acquired, which can be lost, means intrinsically something is yours. That intrinsically which is yours cannot be lost. So there he is talking about the intrinsic value as Brahman. The context is you are changing the context and asking the question. The context is not about how jiva moves from one body to another body. Here he is talking about your intrinsic value, that which cannot be lost. You can lose the gunas, correct? Yes or no?
Yeah.
Tamoguna you can lose and become rajoguna. Rajoguna you can lose and become sattvaguna. Sattvaguna you can lose and you can reach the state of transattva. Therefore, if you can lose it, then it's not your intrinsic value. If you can lose it, then it is not. If you can get rid of sattva guna also and becomes transattvic, then the three gunas are also is not your intrinsic nature value. Therefore, Yama is saying remove by negation. Everything has to be removed. To know your intrinsic value, everything has to be removed. When everything is removed, what remains is that Brahman, and that Brahman becomes the intrinsic value. That's the explanation.
I ask this question in the context of as of now I have not reached or I have not realized self. I only have gunas, and in that sense, until it takes, until we merge with the Brahman, when we are associated still with the gunas, vasanas, etc., will those gunas move? Yes. Will I be same?
Yes.
To the next birth?
Yes. But here in the verse, the context that I spoke yesterday, I'm answering in the context of what I spoke yesterday, because the reference is yesterday you said the intrinsic value. So I'm talking about that. You are saying, I am not yet Brahman, correct? I have only gunas. Knowledge is, you should not say that. That's knowledge. You should not say, I have gunas. If you say, I have gunas, how can you say, I have gunas and also Brahman, also Sahajyam will happen? How can that happen? Therefore, you should start saying, the gunas is the barrier you should say. You should not say, I am having gunas. Are you able to follow? Mala. You should not say, gunas, I have gunas. You should not say, I have desires. You should say, gunas are the barrier. Desires are the barrier. Then only the progression will happen rightly. If you keep on saying, anyway, I am not realized. Of course, we all know that you are not. Yeah, if you are realized, you will be talking and I will be listening. No. Roles will be reversed. So we need not, we know that we are not yet realized, number one. Also, we understand that we have a long way to go. That also we understand. That also we don't have a problem. Here we are talking about how to grow. Here we are talking about how to grow. In order to grow, what should happen? In order to grow, what should happen? Disassociation should happen. What is the disassociation? Instead of saying, I have gunas, I have vasanas, you should say, gunas are the barriers. Vasanas are the barriers. One day, the sahyujyam will happen. Are you able to follow? That's why from the beginning, even though it is mechanical, doesn't matter, repeated we say. They are the barriers. Never say it is mine. Never say the gunas are mine. Never say the desires are mine. Never claim anything as yours. If at all you have to claim something as yours, claim the original as yours. But it's a long way to go. No, of course it's a long way to go. What is the starting point? Start claiming it now. When you start claiming it now, it may be mechanical. Doesn't matter, but start. That's how you grow. You follow, Mala?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. When we are talking about the movement of jiva from one body to another body, what moves? That's another context. What is the context? When jiva moves from one physical body to another physical body, what it carries and what it leaves behind? It carries the gunas. It carries the quantum of ignorance knowledge. That it carries. Desires, unfulfillment. That it carries. But they cannot be called as your intrinsic value. How can you call that as an intrinsic value? You cannot call that as an intrinsic value. Your intrinsic value is the reality. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you so much. With this, all of them, Venkat?
Yes,
with this, we conclude and continue with the next verse in the next.